Managing concurrent access to a resource, whether it's a row, a table, or a single value, is easy, as long as no one's trying to modify the underlying data. But what happens if someone changes the data while someone else is reading it? Well, support for non-blocking transactions are enabled by default in Azure SQL Database. Davide and Mauri is here to show us how it works today on Azure Friday. Today, I'm thrilled to welcome Davide Mauri, who is here to talk with us about non-blocking transactions in Azure SQL Database. Welcome, Davide.
Hey, Lara. Thanks for having me, as usual.
As usual. It's great to have you on the show again.
Thank you.
So talk to me. What's going on with non-blocking transactions? And why do they matter?
Yeah, that's a very interesting topic. So, well, you know, you've been using SQL Server for a while, like me and like many out there. And you know that if you start to write or modify a row, like insert, update, or delete something, and you are in the middle of the transaction, so you begin a transaction, you know, do something that changes the data, and before committing or, you know, rolling back your transaction, someone tries to read or access what you're doing, you'll be blocked. So people have to wait in line, basically, right? So this has been the usual behavior since a long time ago. In 2005, SQL Server 2005, we changed a little bit. We introduced what is called row versioning so that you don't have to be blocked. You can, well, let me show you maybe in a demo. It's easier. But long story short, the problem is that in SQL Server, by default, you still are blocked because you need to enable this feature manually. On Azure SQL Database, this is enabled by default. So by default, you don't have to wait. Yeah, so let me show my screen so I can more easily explain what's going on here. So we have our usual table. You know, I created a sample city with some city, and I'm grouping by city name. So there are several rows, one for each city. Now, what I'm doing on the left side, I'm starting a transaction and, you know, making some changes. So let's say I'm inserting a new row and deleting something. I'm still in the transaction right now because I began a transaction, but I never closed it. So ideally, I will close the transaction later. But let's say my transaction is a long-running transaction. So I'm in the middle of the transaction. Now, someone else can try to read my data. I'm doing it in a, from another connection, so simulating another application. And right now, I'm simulating the usual behavior, the default behavior that has been there since, you know, always in SQL Server. And that's why I need to specifically put this hint here, just to simulate what's happening. You see, this second connection is just waiting, and it will wait for as long as we wish or until this transaction is done.
Now, that's the default behavior in the box in SQL Server on-prem.
Exactly. And of course, we kept this because we want to keep, you know, backward compatibility.
We don't want to break.
But of course, on Azure SQL, we can change a little bit things, especially for, you know, cloud-born application that doesn't have any ties with existing or past application. So what happened in Azure SQL by default, again, without having to manually specify anything, is that, let me recreate my table, show that I have exactly the same data. Now, let me begin the transaction again and stop exactly where I stopped before. Now, without having to do literally anything, I can just select from sample cities and I will be able to access the cities. Now, you may be thinking that I'm seeing the thing I have just deleted. Like if you are a SQL Server user, if you put no lock or read uncommitted. Well, not the case. That's not the case because as you can see here, I deleted everything that is related to Bellevue. But as you can see here, Bellevue is still there. So the two transactions are isolated, which means that this second transaction, this second connection can still see the, let's say, committed data. So that's why it's called read committed snapshot, because until the other transaction is committed, the real data, the existing data, are those that existed before this transaction started to change the data, right? So anyone can still read the committed data, so have you know, the correct data, without have to wait or be blocked. And of course, here on the other transaction, I can still go on, do my update, and then commit. And only after the transaction on the left has been committed, then if I run my application on the right side, I will see the change in data. And this is great because immediately you are faster. You don't have to wait. You can, your application looks like it's more responsive, right? So that's very nice.
And you don't have the blocking of for the readers, which when you design your application with that in mind, it's important to have that low latency response for that application. Exactly. Now, I'm curious though, let's say that we are migrating a database from SQL Server on-prem into Azure. Yeah. And it's important for us to understand that by default, if you're migrating to Azure SQL Database, this behavior may change and it may change your application. So for those that want to have a consistent experience with what they have on-prem, when they do the migration and then maybe make choices later to pull back on the blocking that they may be experiencing, how would we handle that?
Well, they can, of course, if they want. What we saw is that since we keep returning the old data by basically making a copy of the old data into another side of a database, so you still access the data that exists. Because when you are blocked, basically, you are waiting or to get the new data or to get the old data if the transaction is rolled back, right? So usually, the new behavior is just an improvement and doesn't bring problems or any consistency problem to application that are migrated. But in any case, if you still prefer to wait, you can re-enable by or adding read committed lock or just disabling this feature.
All right, so you just change the setting on the database.
Yeah, correct.
Great.
So now let me also show you another example that shows even an improved version of this technique called raw versioning. This is also available on SQL Server, and these actually behave exactly in SQL Server. And this is something you have to manually enable because it increases the amount of work that we need to do behind the scene in order to preserve integrity. But it covers a very interesting case that maybe is not the most common one, but sometimes you need to have complete isolation between the two transactions. And let me explain that in a little bit better. So in the transaction we ran before, we begin a transaction, inserted some data, and then deleted something, right? And then in just one command on the other transaction, we run a select. Now, what happens if the other connection is also a transaction? So let's say I begin a transaction, select something. But now, before we said is the left transaction to be very slow, right? It takes a lot of time. What if is the right transaction, the transaction on the right side, to be very slow, very long? Like, let's say we do a select, and then we have to, do some computation and wait for 15 seconds. It could happen that the transaction on the left finishes before this transaction is done. So which means that I read some data and I know I'm protected by the changes being done during the execution of the other transaction. But if this transaction is then committed, what happens when I reread my data within the same transaction that I haven't finished yet? Well, if I use the regular read commit snapshot, what would happen is that I read the old data, then the transaction on this left side finishes, and then here I read some different data because the transaction on the left has finished, so I'm still reading the committed rows. Maybe I don't want to do that. I want to have something called repeatable read, which means during my transaction, no matter how long it takes, I always want to access the same data I accessed at the beginning of my transaction because I need consistency throughout my transaction. So in order to do that, what we can do is enable something called the snapshot isolation level. So let me show you, first of all, what happened. So let's go back, create the usual sample table. I have my cities here as usual. And now let me run everything without the snapshot isolation level. So with the default read commit snapshot and run a very long transaction. In the meantime here, let me execute this shorter one. So this transaction on the left has finished and has changed some data. And let's wait for this transaction to finish. It should be in a couple of seconds now. You will see two different results. So this is the select that has been done at the beginning. Then the transaction was doing something complex. And then it tried to read the same data and discovered that the data are different. And now if you're trying, for example, to update the data, now that's a problem because you have different set of data. So this is could be something that you don't want to happen. So all you have to do is enable the transaction isolation level called the snapshot, which basically protect you against this issue. So let me go again here, clean up everything, and start this long transaction, making sure that I specify this set transaction isolation level here. Run that and run this transaction again. And what we see is that, like magic, Azure SQL will preserve the changes that has been done on the side, on the left side of my screen, on the transaction left side, so that the right side of my screen, the disconnection, will always see the same data during its own transaction. So this is very important because it really gives you a toggle that you can decide how much consistency you want. Of course, consistency comes with the price of more resources used. So if you just have a normal need, I would say, or a standard need, the read committed level is more than enough and it's enabled by default. You just go, you don't wait. If you also want not to wait for a long transaction where data may be changed during the lifetime of a transaction, then you want to switch to the snapshot isolation level where your transaction is completely isolated and you can, you know, you can make sure that the data will not change during the lifetime of the whole transaction, which sometimes is needed when, you know, you need to have consistency throughout the transaction. So this is pretty cool.
You can change these settings then both at the database level as well as at the connection level or the query level.
Yeah, absolutely. So you have all the option to set this setting exactly where you need, in order to make sure that you use these settings only when they are really used. Because again, we need to keep basically a snapshot, hence the name, of the row that you are touching, and this of course costs resources, right? Just imagine you do a transaction with 100 million rows. Well, we need to keep the snapshot of it. So you really want that to happen if you need it, right?
Right.
So this option gives you the ability to choose exactly how much resource consumption you want to have.
So it seems like there are a lot of different transaction isolation levels that are available for developers to set both on Azure SQL Database as well as on SQL Server and on-prem. Where do we go to learn more about when to use these different settings?
Oh, well, there is a really good documentation online, you know, docs.microsoft.com. We go and explain all the many transaction isolation level we have, because we have many because they all try to do the same thing, but using different technique. Locking is one. The row versioning is another one. And we decided to just go with the row versioning on SQL Azure because we noticed that it costs a little bit more resources, but it gives more performance in the sense that you don't have to wait. So your application is more snappy, your API responds faster. So we guess that's the usual desire. But then you have probably seven or six, I don't remember at the moment, different options you can choose from. Yeah. So yeah, docs.microsoft.com and Azure SQL is, you know, the place where you can learn everything about the transactions.
Sounds great. Thank you so much for joining me today to talk Absolutely. More about non-blocking transactions as well as different transaction isolation levels. It's a great information to learn about.
Yep.
We've been learning all about non-blocking transactions in Azure SQL Database today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.